Would you be so kind to change the slide for the next one, the third slide? According to the next slide, let's see that Aristotle thinks as a foundation of his consideration that everybody strives for knowledge according to nature in metaphysics. He considers objects that provoke human sensitive perception. Consciousness always a man's attitude to his objective reality. The universal connection between object and person. At the same time, is the objective reality represented in the human mind and reproduces objective nature relations of the real world in some idealized form. As a result, real objects imprint in human consciousness, considered as a mind board. It is possible to conclude here that the consciousness emergence always requires a level of human control over the thinking process. Thus, there should be a meaning why he thinks about it, how he does it, if there is any purpose of attention to this object, etc. Consciousness provides the imagination of all meaningful and vital problems, such as what for, if there is a purpose in his life, and so on. It considers images being either the perception or conception, knowledge or sensations being memorized, generalizations being created as a result of the highest physical activity, psychic, thought and language. So consciousness is a special form of interaction with the reality and is controlled. Next slide, please. Now let's talk about the main part and we'll start with the cognition process. This photo with Aristotle was made during the Congress in Aristotle's park in Stagira, where he was born, when there was the Congress in Saloniki devoted to his anniversary, 2,400 years since his birth. And so, according to Aristotle, objects precede the cognition process. As soon as a scientist contemplates an object, this object and its knowledge enter the reality. So, into the slides, we can say that's why he considers, Aristotle considers knowledge as a specific kind of objective reality. Next slide, please. It's necessary to know that the main scientific method introduced by Aristotle is induction, ascending from less to more obvious thing by its nature, procedural to general. Inductive conclusions don't make such the true sense, but they form the preparation, threshold possible to see to it. He offers to start without any proof from the beginning. That is what is taken as the beginning of cognition process. However, in modern science, it's hard to determine a clear border between induction and deduction, as they're equally important for the appropriate cognition process. Next slide. So cognition process is divided into the following stages by Aristotle. The first one is sensitive perception. Then experiences a number of perceptions of the same object. Tekne as general knowledge, that is generalization of experimental knowledge. And science philosophy is believed to take the highest position in the knowledge. Karina, would you be so kind to switch on the next slide? So Aristotle conceived knowledge should possess the following fundamental features. Is validity, that is characterized by necessity, logical connection of everything related to the reality. Aristotle believes that the connection between a cognoscitive and presence ought to be necessary and demonstrate significant regular at length. He distinguishes three types of proofs and lists three proof doctrines. The first one, according to second point item in our slide, is epidiectic logic. The second one is dialectic, and the third heuristic or sophism. Heuristic proofs being sophisms are generic, as the arguing sides exchange them and they both want to get the back truth. According to Aristotle, dialectics coincides with logic as a kind of proof issuing from believable premises. Subject and object of the cognition process are related by probable. Epidiectic is opposed to dialectic, as is strict knowledge resulting from general premises with a necessity. The leaf also possesses generality, since it's impossible to prove emergent disintegrating things or occasional ones, but only general objects. The third fundamental feature that I'd like to pay attention to is possibilitation. That is, the purpose of the scientific knowledge is not just to fix the fact of subject existence, but to reach its essence being. And the final one today is combination of unity with degrees of knowledge subordination that leads to the classification. The higher degree a science has in this classification, the more exact and valuable knowledge it possesses. On the next slide, you'll see some words concerning Aristotle's heritage. I try to demonstrate his belief in the power of mind, stress the objectivity of cognition. Aristotle formulated a number of methodological requirements to the latter. The necessity to conceive the phenomena in the process of their modification, the principle of causality, etc. His merit is the first detailed classification of sophistical methods that can mislead in the cognition process. It is his scientific heritage where science and philosophy are picking up. They stand out from the initial integrated knowledge and wisdom. So, and we can see it on this slide. Aristotle is the first scientist who gives the classification of knowledge types. Issues, theoretical, philosophy, physics, mathematics, practical, ethics, policy, and creative sciences. Logic isn't included in this system, as it is considered as propedeutic to all other than methodology. He looks at it as the most important phenomenon, having the double nature. It provides the beginning of the formal approach analysis, but at the same time defines the way of getting coinciding with the object. Thus, Aristotle tries to overcome logic, putting a question about its content. So, logic and epistemology are closely connected with his doctrine of and concept of truth. The knowledge sphere is defined as object contemplation, theory, deduction. Estimating Aristotle's heritage is necessary to point out that epistemological ideas are realistic. Objects of cognition exist before it has been seen, as it continues its being after exception in the same condition. Consciousness and object are independent of each other, and object leaves an imprint in consciousness field at the moment of their meeting. Aristotle's epistemology, emphasizing of inductive wording of the totality leading to the identification and deductive consequences obtained from them. So, Karina, switch on the next slide, and it will be devoted the meaning. Включайте, пожалуйста, the previous slide, тот, который был. Let's return slide. Yeah, this one. Now, ой, нет, где вот вот этот да, this one. Subject of cognition. Thank you. So now we'll talk about our second, which I have mentioned in the topicality of today's lecture, to connect Aristotle's heritage with modern epistemology in philosophical practice. So, do we follow, here arises the question, do we follow the same procedure in the cognition process at present? As already been said, Aristotle, and we can see it on the slide, Aristotle didn't introduce an idea of subject of cognition, as is the reflection of a cognizable object by human mind. As a rule, an epistemology understands subject of cognition as a corporal individual with hints and meaning, content structures that is involved in the definite social environment influencing his communicative and other relations. From my point of view, rather important position on the slide. Subject of cognition can also be considered as a group of people or a team nowadays. That's why the cognition is possible through achieving a collective consent. Nowadays, instead of searching the absolute truth, it's suggested based on the equality of various subjective views and constructing not only specific conceptions by subjects, but objects being under consideration. Hence, subjects exist only in the unity of me, in the human or in the subjective relationships, cognitive and real activity, writes Hans Lenk in his book Grasping Reality, an epistemology that was published in the year 2003. Thus, it gives the interaction of various subjective positions in view of reality and specificity. Now, Karina, would you be so kind to the next slide? Now, let's talk about objects, and also I want to say that it's not a sudden photo. When we talk about Aristotle again, it was Naira our guide told us it was so square. Wonderful view, yeah, from my point of view, wooden lift and thought, yes. So, according to Aristotle, human conflict the cognizable object. Now the conversation is about objects. Modern constructivism theory considers the construction of the surrounding object in the limits of his perception and mentality. The mind doesn't process the information received outside anymore, only situation specified. Following the method of searching, object of cognition process is a question. which subject hasn't answered. Besides, he is not able to get it from his memory. Direct observation, reading textbooks or reference books, or asking specialists. While object forms an objective field, it's a relatively narrow circle of phenomena concerning the search of an answer to a cognitively significant question directly. And subject constructs his perception. The constructs obtained may not be needed with the real world, but correspond only to subject's experience. If the knowledge achieved conforms to the reality, it means the presence of the construct with the world perceived that can be both subjective and any border between inner, that is taking place inside the subject of cognition, and outer, that is its environment, is removed in the today. This means that reality is not just a result of subject's construction. Today it is supposed, with respect to rational and cognitive activities, some on the basis of theoretical schemes and models, methodological empiric information and logic norms of reasoning. This is the basis for making a decision regarding a mode of action to resolve a current problem. Such a choice from a number of alternatives and a range of possibilities is typically constructive thinking and is therefore open for future. It can be concluded the subject is not a closed system, but is rather the world. While Aristotle suggested that object was reflected but and didn't depend on it, nowadays everything that really exists and doesn't can be regarded as object of cognition. It can be not an item, but the whole complex of a system, both natural and ideal. According to Vladislav Lipsky, he writes article classical in his book Classical and Non-Classical Epistemology, a theme existing in space and time, any objective for reason can be considered as object of cognition. It can be subject's consciousness and his personality in general, another person, his consciousness, cultural item, including books, and their meanings. The spectrum of the object has significantly widened due to a new system of ideals and non-cognition process. It has allowed discovering the ways to research and map self-regulating systems. Next slide, please. Of Aristotle's epistemology, the main feature of Aristotle's epistemology was to get the truth. But nowadays, the epistemological process is directed to the recognition of different, irreducible to each other positions that has been upon their realization. It is also to consider the reality as multi-level one. Different levels of cognition are not reducible to each other, though there is dependence among them. As an example of substituting its relationship by the process of observation, it's possible to provide the idea theory of autopoiesis by Maturana and Varela. According to man is a living system, doesn't just reflect the world surrounding him. Constructs the world in correspondence with his cognitive, existential, and social. As an autopoietic system, man progresses in the while broadening his relations with the world. Accordingly, this list of inner and outer relations that then form his personal space. The main ideas, the main features of autopoiesis I have given on this slide. I'd like to mention that features. The first feature is operational insularity. So the self-organization process is possible due to the back based on the system's inner laws, and is not guided from the outside. Next feature, information insularity. Any outer should be transformed into an inner brain activity because such a system can correspond on activity. And the third feature is physical openness. The range of substances and energy with the environment and its character is defined by a system. A system's inner state forms subject's idea of the environment. However, and we can see it in the third point on the slide, there is always an outer observer who could play the role observed. In fact, this process of changing observers is limitless, and there can be no last observer. The exclusive observation system doesn't exist. This means that active knowledge about the world cannot be achieved. Thus, it's possible that the achievement of some balance between reality and the result of subject's cognitive activity is imperative. Since subject constructs the world, everyone has his own reality. In this sense, subject doesn't feel any boundary between his own experience and the reality. Hence, cognition equates the adaptation. Object exhibits something similar to subject activity. Observation of the second order. According to the observation of the second order by Nicholas Luhmann, observation can consist of characteristics that create a complex system. Cells, societies, systems of artificial intellect are able to play the role of. The second order observation or an observation of an observation is different because of the circumstances of each observation. That is, if an observer has performed it or someone or something has been observing him. According to theory, an observer cannot see himself. That is, he is not able to recognize himself in his observation. At the same time, however, another observer can see him. Case, object has an ability to see the observer and to see what is being observed. Luhmann defines this process as a second-order observation or auto-reflection concept, belief. It is these conditions that serve as the foundation of epistemology. The concept of observation allows us to avoid the epistemological traditionology that we can find in Aristotle's works, in particular, the subject of. For example, it is possible to consider the relationships between a system and its environment while observing the system. Nicholas Luhmann writes that his own systems operate inside the man as a condition of his life. He defines the operations they implement by means of their own structures, but they are dependent on each other. Thus, this explanation promotes that the world of observation is created the same way as any other system activity. Accordingly, the answers to the ontological questions, what is it and how is it, on a definite observer who is restricted by the world of his observation. The observer is similar to some empiric value that stipulates selecting him as an object observer. It's obvious the subject and the environment in which he acts are inconstructively and therefore experience union in the process of subject activity. Next slide, please. Now some conclusions. First of all, it's possible to conclude that nowadays cognition is considered a process of subject activity. First, cognition is abstracting the reality, and it's given on the slide in the first item, subject by means of his cognitive operation, which explains why the knowledge received is a construct of the reality than of its reflection. The cognition process and its result, some knowledge, are equal. Object is able to cognize only the object he created himself from this position, to consist of this process. Thus, the cognition process organizes objects in words, but it doesn't solve the problem of how to describe the objective ontological. Subject is considered as a part of the world that he's going to observe, or as a part of some system that will be observed by other observers. Thus, every subject has his own reality. That is, obtaining rational knowledge cannot be achieved as Aristotle's truth is eluded, because every subject has his own truth. It means the real knowledge, as the knowledge differs from subject, differs for each. To stress that Aristotle's heritage is numerous and varied. His works became a study of modern ideas concerning the cognitive operations, their methods and results in the surrounding world, while turning it to it in the inhabited world, inhabited one. The first, my conclusion is given on the slide that Aristotle started developing the way of understanding the human thinking activity that is responsible for special procedures of transforming real ideal ones existing only in thought. So the second conclusion of the analysis of reasonable cognition led to such a consideration of subject epistemological activity that is integrally connected with the nature of as a rationalized form of the worldview consciousness. And conclusion, it makes philosophy different from such forms of the world of religion, mythology, aesthetics, and artistic perception reality. The issue concerning the rational comprehension and decision of ethical problems, such as man's attitude to the world and vice versa, it's an opportunity of understanding the objective reality, the universe, and the view given by Aristotle, not as key philosophical problem, but as a problem concerned of philosophy existence and the limits of its opportunities. And the final is some perspective. Aristotle demonstrated philosophy is an independent free thought and man's aspiration, standing the world and himself, relying on his own powers and abilities. So, philosophy has kept this sense from my point of view so far. Why, like Aristotle's epistemology, the contemporary theory of knowledge is towards the future. It raises new and new issues and opens limitless appetite for the mankind. That's all. Thank you for your attention. I will be very glad to ask any questions if you have.
I have one question. How did Aristotle's ideas influence on your own path in philosophical practice? Maybe in your practice in the institute or something.
I can hear some break. I'd like to clarify the question. Can I understand that the question is about using Aristotle's work in my philosophy practice as a university? Am I right? No?
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. So I would like to say that, of course, we start the course of philosophy, I think, not only in Russian Federation, in the Russian Federation, but probably everywhere. Just because I work for technical university, we have got technical students who are preparing to be who are trained to be engineers, various fields, especially IT sphere. And of course, with the antique philosophy, just because, especially Aristotle's just because it, from my point of view, it perfectly creates critical thinking, yes, the possibilities of critical thinking, and as it's given in the slide, perspective, we can look at the subject, at ourselves, how we think, and as the object, especially for natural or maybe specialities, that we can look at this position from this view. Nobody and nothing limits us, yes? So I think that Aristotle's work and his way of thinking, his approach to the book, stimulates the students, as it's written in the slide, to raise new issues. And it opens them the limitless opportunities in the field of their thinking, yes, their thinking. First of all, to think that, of course, there are teachers, there are tutors, there are lecturers, but everybody should, and sometimes we can say that must have in our contemporary, very fast developing his position, yes, he has right on this position and his ideas. And first of all, it's necessary just because people, yes, I give lectures and classes to Russian, and we have got nowadays some foreign students from the first year when students get bachelor degree up to postgraduate students, and onto each level, of course, I think that everybody opens something new in Aristotle's way of thinking, yes, and of course his thoughts are to develop our thinking ability in all fields, yes, in all fields. I think this way why he is important, and I think that his works out of any philosophical practice, and especially started, as I said, that photos, yes, were made in 2012 in Saloniki, when Saloniki University invited us and took us to, especially to the place where considered that Aristotle was born. Idea was that even after 2,000 years, I think every man, maybe it's not a philosophy, but any thinking practice, of course, starts and probably next 2,400 years, again, we'll start with Aristotle's scientific, yeah, from why I decided to stress epistemology, scientific way of thinking, just because it more corresponds to my field of activity, yes, it's closer to science. That's what is the reason why I decided to take not gnosiology in general, but epistemology. For that, this Congress has invited me this lecture, and I'm very thankful to all listen to me and ask me a question.
Я хотела спросить вас, а возможно ли с вами, допустим, сотрудничать, возможно, консультироваться по вопросам вот как раз применения этих знаний, внедрения их в свой преподавательский процесс?
И да, конечно, пожалуйста, у вас есть почта и телефон. Я буду очень рада, да, я всегда открыт новых, да, и мне, я очень люблю и поучиться сама, и предложить умею, поэтому я буду очень рада, пожалуйста, всегда. Да. Всегда на связи.
Welcome. Dear Naira Vladimirovna, je suis très glad to see you at our conference, and I have a question. You know that very famous question that was posed by Иммануэл Кант. What can I know? What I do? What may I hope for? Is there any something like these three questions that may be found in the philosophy of Aristotle?
Your talk is
entitled as Modern Philosophical Practice. But I think that modern age began with the philosophy of Immanuel Kant.
Mm-hmm.
So my question is the following. Can you, these three famous questions of Immanuel Kant, what can I know, what I do,
and
what may I hope for? Can this question maybe trace it back to Aristotle?
To say the truth, I have that in this way, just because the purpose of this was preparing for it as modern philosophical practice through Aristotle ideas. To demonstrate them from, first of all, scientific thinking. But, of course, I have already said I think that from my, it's just my belief, maybe, of course, I strongly believe that mainly Aristotle treated philosophy as an independent free thought. So open questions, of course, we have always said. Probably, you are right that most philosophy starts with Kant, with his open question, with antinomies. But I think that antinomies and these open questions, if it is philosophy, they have been and they will always be. But if you ask me to formulate and exactly these open questions, direct connection with the Aristotle's ideas, I should recognize now that it's difficult for me. Yeah, it's difficult for me just that they are open. I think author is open and we can always write, yes. And my complete lecture, I wanted to demonstrate, in this lecture, that simply understand. I didn't mention, for example, there are a lot of words. I just told the activism, and tried to say that subject and object can be understood. Also open questions, what is subject is an open question, and it will always question. And what is object? How we understood the object? What connection is without them? Don't exist at all, as to follow the constructivism theory and what are the relations between them. So probably if to reply to your question, I think that the first open question that raised Aristotle is, and to his logic, is who cognizes, how we cognize the means of cognition, and what is cognized. Of course, these are open questions. If to follow my lecture, what I'm trying to demonstrate today, there is no one, there is no single here, and more than not only epistemology, but missiology, if we can say theory of thinking in general, it gives new and new variants. Now, for example, nowadays, French director Berlin's Latour and many Latour, if it's to say in English, sorry, I always make a mistake when I pronounce his name, with his actor network theory, where there is no object and no object is absolutely new way of thinking. So I think that he made the main kind to think questions forever. How we understand, who cognizes, what is the means of cognition. I think this way, if I understand I want to thank you for technical support. Thank you very much that your university and Congress invited me to make this lecture. Thank you once again.